Okay. No. Each side have four states. So spin zero, spin one are different. So they really split. It's a one block, one by one block, and three by three block. Indeed, that would be identity matrix. No, spin zero. On this side, we don't have irreducible. We have a reducible representation. This is the key. Yeah, if you have irreducible on each side, that's the identity matrix. Okay. And so here, I just want to add a little bit. So certainly, if this system is one-dimensional, we cannot break. But we can certainly define this system in any dimension. Okay. If you define this system in some higher dimension, then those extension can also break. And here we know they all behave like boson, also pretty trivially. So if you do add the braiding, they all braid as a boson, and also have with trivial mutual statistics. There's no non-trivial mutual statistics. And so when you add the braiding, then we have this so-called braided fusion category. So if you don't think of braiding, just a fusion category, add the braiding, it's a braided fusion category. But this is a very trivial, very simple braided fusion category because everything is boson, everything have a trivial mutual statistics. And this particular kind of braided fusion category have a name called a symmetric fusion category. And their data are basically just Ni, Jk, and F. Okay. And so, adding more structure. But here, this more structure is that they're all trivial. So all these particles is boson. And they have trivial mutual statistics. When they go around each other, there's no phase. So we say you can add a braiding, but here is a trivial braiding. For this particular example, we have a trivial braiding. Okay. So why we do this? Because this is related to the question I asked, is that suppose you have a system with a symmetry, but all your probe respect symmetry. There's no symmetry breaking probe. So that means we have this, all our trap are symmetric. All the trap are symmetric. And then can you recover symmetry group? Because all your probe is have respect symmetry. You cannot do symmetry transformation because that's break symmetry. So using symmetric probe, can you determine the symmetry and can you determine the symmetry group? So physically, this Nijk and F, etc., is a data I can measure using symmetric probe. So that's the data I can collect using symmetric probe. And then I ask, when you collect those data, certainly including the trivial fusion, trivial braiding, that's also we can collect using symmetric probe. When you have all those data, can you determine the symmetry group? The answer is yes. Actually, there's a quite famous mathematical theorem. Is that a symmetric fusion category with this trivial braiding, trivial statistics, would uniquely determine a symmetry group? This is a one-to-one correspondence. And so this is basically is a way to describe a symmetry without break symmetry. Or another way to say it's like a categorical description of the symmetry. So that's a categorical description of symmetry. And later we are going to use that. I'm not sure I can get there. But anyway, this is the categorical way to describe symmetry. Yes. So there's a unique way to determine the fermion group. Since the raises question, so it's very simple that we just, for the fermion, that means a certain representation are really fermions. So therefore, we just modify here. Some representation of boson, other are fermions. They all have a trivial mutual statistic among each other. So that's another generalization. And I think I have U there. So in the categorical way to describe symmetry, including fermion, is very simple. You just modify this some representation of fermion, some representation of boson, that would be the fermion symmetry. So therefore, when you're using categorical way to describe symmetry, then to classify topological order for fermion system or for boson system be on an equal footing. They're very similar theory. Yeah, so actually that's why we do this. Yeah. But this is very important, using categorical picture to describe fermion symmetry. So let's also reflect one thing, that category theory sounds very abstract and mathematical, but actually it's a very physical, it's experimental way to look at the things. That is, so suppose our universe, for example, suppose our fundamental theory have a time-reversal symmetry, and then all your probe, all your equipment respect time-reversal symmetry. And then you perform all kind of experiments respect time-reversal symmetry, but how you probe the symmetry, you know. So this is the way. And so actually this NIJKF are experimental accessible data using symmetric probe. So it's really about using symmetric probe, using the tool you have, what the data you have. And but certainly that's it's kind of complicated to describe a symmetry, because we are using experimental data to describe symmetry rather than using theoretical illusion to describe a symmetry, which is harder but more physical. So in some sense, category theory is a more physical, supposed to be more experimentalist friendly. We'll see. Yeah. Yeah, I think that's probably a possibility. I think for ISO 3 group, you do have infinite number for simple object. But however, usually in mathematics, people usually don't talk about that. It's because the theory became a little bit hard. But I think there should be a way to define the category theory with infinite number of simple object. There should be a nice theory. There should be a way to handle infinity, because physically, you know, compact symmetry group and non-compact symmetry group do not have too much difference, and that suggests there should be a way to do it. But at the moment, the mathematician concentrates on the finite simple object, so that's only why you do finite group. I'm sorry. Yeah, this is all for finite group, and for non-compact group, for compact group, I don't know. Yeah. Okay, so I mentioned that those fusion categories come from the group. If they come from group, you know, have representation. And we have a very important thing is the dimension of representation. That tells us the degeneracy, tells us the internal degree of freedom. Okay, so therefore, when you have a fusion category coming from the group, we have this internal degree of freedom, just a dimension of this representation. That's something very natural thing. So that is called a quantum dimension. It's really dimension of internal degree of freedom. But however, when you have an abstract way to define fusion category, not from group, then there's a little bit tricky. So what is the internal degree of freedom for each object? Is that always a one or not equal to one or what? So this is relate to this. A kind of a issue about what is quantum dimension in a more general setting. So here, to define quantum dimension, we will consider the fusion space of many object, which is I. Suppose we have a lot of same type, lot of I fused together. And then we ask, what is the dimension for fusion space when number of I is large, when n is large? It turns out that in general, this dimension is not integer raised to nth power. You know, usually if I have internal degree freedom, which is some integer, then the total dimension fusion space will be this integer raised by some power of how many I do we have. Okay. But in our case, in general, this is not the case. But however, there's some number here. We still call this number a quantum dimension. And this quantum dimension is like the internal degree of freedom, which can be a non-integer or fractional one. So how to compute this quantum dimension? Again, we really just fuse many I together. So here we fuse I and I into M1. Okay, then we fuse M1 to I, and etc. Then using this fusion coefficient by summing over all possible channels, we can get the dimension of fusion space. So we can compute the dimension of fusion space just using this fusion coefficient. So this became this kind of contraction, summing over through all the channel M1, M2, etc. However, this kind of contraction can be written as a matrix form. We can view this rank 3 tensor as a rank 2 tensor with a 1 index. Okay, so this Jik became a tensor, a matrix with a label I, but the Jk became matrix index, so Jk is a matrix index. So if using this this matrix, you'll find this sum is just a this matrix Ni raised to n minus n power, I'm taking a particular element, ith element, and one element, this particular element. And then when n is very large, I think roughly this this matrix scale up as the largest eigenvalue. You know, the largest eigenvalue would that how far they scale. So we will assume there is a non-trivial overlap. So this particular element have this non-trivial overlap with this largest eigenvalue, eigenvector. So we say when they may scale with di to the nth power, where di is the largest eigenvalue of the ni, and that's it. So by considering the largest eigenvalue of this positive integer matrix, we get a quantum dimension. Okay. And then here we can really distinguish abelian and non-abelian particle. If quantum dimension equal to 1, this particle must be abelian particle, means with abelian statistics. And then the non-abelian particle would have a quantum dimension bigger than 1. There's nothing smaller than 1. And so because this matrix satisfies certain conditions, so all the quantum dimension are bigger than 1. There's nothing smaller than 1. Yes. Yeah, equal to 1, so that's integer.
Maybe 2.
Oh, I see. Yeah. No. It's not guaranteed. Certainly, you know, for the example of this group theory we just described, yeah, they are both and they are abelian. But there are examples where quantum dimension is integer, but the statistics are not abelian. One example, I think, is this. That's probably too. Okay, one example is this non-abelian gauge theory in 2 dimension. And I think the charged particle and also vortex particle probably all have integer quantum dimension. But at least their mutual statistics is non-abelian, Barry's phase. Not quite. Yeah, this di really like a spin. It's related more like a spin. You know, electron have spin up, spin down. Di equal to 2 is really internal degree of freedom. It's really internal degree of freedom. And so then why we say di equal to 1 is abelian, di not equal to 1 is not abelian? It's because when di equal to 1 means when you're fusing I particle together, the total dimension of a fusion space is 1 dimension. So when you braid them, you can only differ by a phase. It's the dimension is 1 dimension. But however, if d is not equal to 1, when you fuse many, many particles, this will grow something like that. So the fusion space is a multi-dimensional vector space. And when you braid this particle, the non-abelian Barry phase can be a SU n matrix. Yeah, so that's basically the di is very important, but to give you room to have a non-abelian twist. Yeah, but the di is interpreted as internal degree of freedom. But however, when di is not integer, this internal degree of freedom is not localized at each I. It's really like a between I. It's like a Marana zero mode. It's we have a degree of freedom there, but it's hard to say exactly where it's localized. So in this case, actually, this di represent a topological degeneracy. But that's a definition, because the fusion space is a topological degeneracy. It's robust against any perturbation. And so this di is really associated with the dimension fusion space that's also representing degree freedom, which cannot be lifted by any local perturbation. That's kind of intuition. Yeah, can be fractional. And actually, someone correctly said I shouldn't say fractional degree freedom because fractional usually means a rational number. So I should say non-integer to be more precise. Okay. So as already mentioned, in one dimension, we only have fusion. So fusion really describes the one dimension. And then we here, let me make a remark. You know, every fusion category describes a possible non-abelian statistics in one dimension. The next question asks, can we realize that? The answer is no. So they say you're talking about something non-existing. This is why you do that. You know, this is not that bad. It's realizable as a boundary of 2D system. So it's not totally non-existing. So although this fusion category, this non-abelian statistic is not realizable by pure 1D system, but it is realizable by 2D system. And then so from this point of view, you can say that this fusion category classify all the possible gap, the boundary of a 2D system. Because when the boundary have a gap, then you have this trap, you can define particle, you can define this non-abelian, this statistic of this number fusion category. So the fusion category classify possible gap, or gap the boundary of 2D system. Then it classify all possible 2D topology order with a gap of a boundary. You know, so from here you can really see that's this connection. Also not rigorously, but in some kind of a reasonable way. And then you say, yeah, it's classified gap the 2D topology order, but do they really exist? Whether, you know, is do we really have a 2D topology order realize every fusion category? And this is what Michael talked about, this string net theory. That's basically using the data of Ni, Jk, and F, you can construct a concrete commuting projection model in two dimensions. We realize every one of these fusion category. So that became a story that this fusion category as a statistics of on a one dimensional statistics, and the 2D topology order with the Galois boundary, and they are really very closely related. Yeah. Okay. Any question here? Okay, so now we can go to next dimensions. Yeah. Non what? Yeah, this is a I don't know. Yeah, this is a very very good question. And so basically, I understand that your question is that. You know, it is possible that some of UFC is not realizable even as a boundary of 2D system. There are no such thing. They're all realizable. Because of this construction, using Ni, Jk, and F symbol, we really get a 2D system. So they're all realizable. But as a general question is that when you use some data to describe something, there's concern. This data is not realizable in the same dimension, but not even realizable as a boundary of a higher dimension. So the data need a certain consistency to be either realizable in the same dimension or realizable as a boundary. But as a general theory, you know, I don't quite understand, you know, how much consistency a data should have so that it would appear at least as a boundary of something. But that's a you know, we will encounter this problem later, but this is a very interesting question. You know, in one dimension, we have a full answer. Unitary fusion category is the most general one-dimensional statistics, and every one of them are realizable. And you can ask similar thing in higher dimension, and a similar question, and the answer there is not very clear, yeah. But that will be the wonderful, interesting question to study, you know, yes. Yeah, there are examples. But what I try to say is that we try to using this more general setting to describe some kind of two-dimensional so-called Brady diffusion category, which may not be realizable on the surface. But however, our condition seems not strong enough. We got too many examples, and I doubt every one of them can realize a boundary. So maybe we need a stronger condition to make sure they are at least anomalous. You know, something can be worse than anomalous, and this is the one of the difficulty we are facing. Yeah. Oh, that's a very good question, because we show that there is no topological order in 1D. But this is a non-trivial result, is that in 1D system, when you have energy gap, then there's a rigorous mathematical proof. Those states have a matrix product representation. Okay. And then when you have a matrix product representation, there's another result. So every matrix product extension representation is equivalent to the product states. They're all local unitary equivalent to product states. So therefore, in 1D gap system, they are all equivalent to product states. There's no topological order. All USA are anomalous. Yeah. So, but they all realize as a boundary for 2D system. Yeah. Non-trivial. So now you can see where we are getting. So if you go one more dimension, you can add more structures. Yes. That's with the symmetry. You know, when you have a symmetry, things are different. You know, when I say no topological order, it means no symmetry. Now, with topology, it has an SPD state. Actually, this supposed to be SPD state should appear here. So actually, that's very interesting. I think the cocycle is encoded in the F symbol. Okay. When you have a braiding, then this matrix should be symmetric. You know, before, the nijk may not be symmetric under exchange of I and j in one dimension. That can happen. If you go to one more dimension, you can rotate ij, you know, in two dimension. So they should have same fusion. And so this should be symmetric. That's one condition. Then another condition is that we have mutual statistics, so that means we can braid I all the way around the j. Okay, it's like two exchange. One exchange is this R matrix. The two exchange will be like the full two pi braiding. But however, this mutual statistic angle depend on the fusion channel. You can see ij. IJ have this fusion space. This fusion space can be written as a direct sum of some simple object of a K. So that's like a fusion IJ became K. Okay. When you try to braid I around the J, you don't get a phase. You get a different phase. But which phase do you get depend on in which channel? Because IJ fusion space can be blocked, can have a block form in terms of those K. Each block form, you have one phase. In different block, you have another phase. So therefore, we usually say that this phase depends on the fusion channel. So that's why, although we just go around the J once, but the phase we get have this K dependence. It's really this phase like a block diagonal. And in different block, we have different phase. But this block are labeled by this K. Okay. So again, if you have this picture of this splitting, then this is very easy to understand. Okay. But there's another data is the fractional spin we talk about. We just twisting the particle by 360 degree, you may get a phase, and that is SI. That's a fractional spin, which we discussed before. Then there is a relation. So actually, these two data are not independent. So they have related this way. So basically, if you know the spin, you know the theta. You know. So we don't need this, we just need that. It's very easy to understand because we have ij, we can rotate the whole thing by 2 pi. Then that's really like you're rotating k by 2 pi. So therefore you get this spin of k. But the rotating whole thing by 2 pi is like you're moving I around the j by 2 pi, then spin ij independently by 2 pi. And so it's this side is this. So these are the same. So therefore, we only need, we don't need this. Okay. So that is the data for the braiding. So you can see that we should have a theta and a si, but actually we only need the si. And you also need R matrix, because theta only corresponds to the full braiding, but we have exchange braiding, which should be R matrix. And here, I just ignore them. I just forget it. So I pretend I only have a nijk describe a fusion ring, f symbol describe changing basis, and this spin describe spin and mutual statistics. And then I also do something even more brave. I drop a f, because as I already said, I hate f. And so I have nijk and si. And then the claim is that that's enough. You know, to describe a fusion, we need nijk and f. F is a rank 10 tensor, it's a mess. But when we add braiding, we should have at least have nijk, f, and s. But for some magical reason, we don't need f, because s already determines f. So we can drop f. So actually, the theory for the braided fusion gap is simple. And this data is enough. At least conjecturally, you know, it's a conjecture. Nobody proved that. And mathematicians, some believe it, some don't believe it. But because it's so simple, so as a physicist, we will, for the time being, believe it. And then just using this conjecture, go ahead. So therefore, the theory for braided diffusion category, that when you add braiding, we call the braided diffusion category are simpler, just this data. So the next, so really that's one of important result is that using this set of data to describe non-abelian statistics in two dimension, which seems a simpler theory. Okay. Yeah.
Is there a simple example where f doesn't matter, or f does not appear, or f is totally determined by n?
Yes. That is a belief. It's hard to believe, you know? The rank 10 tensor and simplified to this single vector. But so far, there's no exception, you know? All different braid diffusion category, modular one, actually modular one. Without the modular, that's not true. So I should add the modular one, but at this level, I haven't introduced this concept, so I don't say that. But for us, this is enough. F exists, but that matter means fully determined by nijk and si. You don't need them as independent data, because there's a lot of condition among them. F exists, R exists, they all exist. But I tried to hear the conjecture is that F and R do not exist as independent data.
You construct that from
NI. Exactly, yeah. They are fully determined. Basically, it means there's no every distinct fusion category, or braid fusion category modular one, have a distinct set of data in this set. No, that's not modular. So there's a for this statement to be true, we need not kind of modular condition, which I don't specify yet. For non-modular one, this is not true. And then whole thing became very difficult, and so we don't know. But anyway, so this is the statement, the conjecture. And so the here we include central charge C, which is not very important, so let not spend time on it. So basically, nijk si classify everything. And so this is a conjecture. And then we made another conjecture before, SNT classify everything. Okay. So actually these two are consistent. So there is a direct relation between SNT and NIJ, K and S. And say from ST and C, we can get I, J, S, I, and C. So that this expression called the Van Dyke formula. So if you know the S, you know the N. Then the S and the T relation is very straightforward. It's a, the eigenvalue of a T is the S. So the eigenvalue of T, if T is diagonal, you know, then the eigenvalue of T is S. But with the shift of the C, there's a bicentral charge. And so then there's the other way is that certainly this can be easily inverted. So if you know the T, you know, if you know the S, you know the T. But there's also a formula that if you know N, I, J, K, and S, you know the S. And this is a quantum dimension computed from N, I, J, K, you know. So these are both, these two sets of labeling each are one by one. So as conjecture, each are one by one for topology order. And so therefore, now you can see that we have a condition on S and T, which is a representational modular representation. You know, and we have get some condition on N and S, okay, and we can combine these two conditions to get an even bigger set of condition, and this bigger set condition will be is enough actually. It became a theory for unitary modular tensor category, and so that's basically how we handle this problem. Yes. There are one. Yeah, we shouldn't have a paper which is with really about this. There's a similar Van Lennep formula in 3+1 dimension. Okay, the standard point of view for unity module tensor category is really in terms of N, F, and R. So this is a different. This is very hard to deal with because F have a Pannegan equation, R have a hexagon equation. They all very nonlinear, but it's hard to deal with. But here is like a. We have a simplified unitary tensor category theory, although the simplification is a conjecture. And so now we want to derive those relations. You know, you say those are kind of magical. You know, how you derive this relation? And actually, there's a pretty simple way. It's like some kind of graph calculus. So it's kind of it's cool to draw them. And so one can. When using this way of thinking to do a lot of things, you know, so that's why I present how to derive this relation, and in some simplified version. So first, I need to have this some point of view of topological quantum field theory point of view of this whole thing. And so, in topological quantum field theory, as axioms, is like that we have a d-dimensional closed manifold, which is space. Okay. On this space, we have a vector space. We have a Hilbert space. Okay. And so physically, this really means that we have a system defined on this manifold, and this vector space, our degenerate ground state subspace. That's it. That's how physical we interpret this. Okay, that's a one content in the topological quantum field theory. The another thing is that for the d+1 dimensional open manifold, okay. Then we have then the open manifold means that this manifold have a boundary. The boundary is this closed manifold in this one lower dimension in space. Okay. Then on this boundary of open manifold, we have a vector in this vector space. We have a particular vector in this vector space. And physically, this means that so we have a space manifold. And we have a degenerate ground state in vector space. And we have universe, have a Big Bang. So the universe grows, a birth here, and it expands to our space. And this particular evolution would give rise to a particular vector in this vector space, a particular ground states. So that's what this means. So we have there's a geometrical interpretation of a vector space and a particular vector in the vector space. They are associated with this open manifold. And then we have a partition function. And there is several ways to look at it. So one way to look at the partition function is that we have a closed space-time. Okay, the closed space-time have no boundary, means the boundary is a empty set. But there's an axiom that the empty, if this closed manifold is empty, and there's it's a one-dimensional Hilbert space. So there's something. So that means so the partition function is a vector in a one-dimensional vector space, which is simply another way, mathematician's way to say it's a number. And so partition function is a complex number, so it's within this axiom. But however, this number have a surgical formula to view this number. That is, we can cut this boundary into two, cut this space-time manifold into two. And then on each boundary, we have a vector. And then this path is like gluing these two vectors together. And so it's really the inner product. And this brown cat corresponds to these two boundaries have a different orientation, etc. This is, you know, if you've been careful about orientation, you get both brown cat. And then you get something like that. So therefore, the inner product of the vector, of this vector, can be expressed as a partition function. So this kind of topological quantum field theory way to view all this content. Then when we have this kind of picture, and then we can derive this relation between this Nijks and Snt. So the first point is that the number of a particle type is equal to the dimension of Snt, or equal to dimension on the torus. Okay. How we view this is, again, we use this universe picture. Suppose we have a torus, then we have a solid torus. So our universe grow from a ring, then expand, became a torus. Okay. And this kind of evolution pick up a particular state on the torus, on this degenerate state on the torus. And this particular state we call 1, or W1. We just call it 1. But then we know that the torus have other states. So how to get other states? To get other states, we just multiply this string operator we discussed before. So that's why I discussed string operator. You know, for every particle type, there's a string operator. We multiply string operator, okay? And then let it evolve. So this string operator can be on the surface or can be buried, because if string operator is buried inside the solid torus, that means after apply string operator, we will let things evolve for another while. So then the string operator will be buried. So here, I draw a string operator as buried. So if in a solid torus, you bury a string operator, then the torus get another state, a new state. So therefore, every degenerate state on the torus have this relation to the different string operator. So this way, like a trivial type, so that's one. One is a trivial type. For non-trivial type, you have non-trivial string operator. Then you get, that's how you get a one-to-one correspondence. And this is not a proof, but at least it's you can see the connection. You know, so it is through this picture we claim that the degeneracy on the torus is equal to string type. Yeah.
So for this case, if I only apply string in this direction, then I get number of states as same number as number of string operators.
Yeah.
How do I prove if I apply the string operator in the other direction?
Yeah.
Direction?
And this picture is really helpful because now you can also apply string in this direction.
Yes.
And that's shrinkable. You can shrink into solid torus and you get nothing. So therefore, if you do that, you get nothing. You may get a face. You don't get orthogonal states.
If I do it alone.
Yeah, because remember, this is not torus. This is solid torus. This string is not shrinkable, but the other direction is shrinkable. And so this is one choice basis. So this solid torus pick another a canonical basis. And these spaces have one-to-one correspondence with a string operator in a non-contractible loop. Yeah. So actually, this is a picture to compute when you have a string operator in the other direction, what the matrix element. You can see it's really coming from the linking of two strings. Yeah, so that's but I don't do this. Okay, so this is someone would ask. The S matrix is this graph. The S matrix, we know that it's a major element on this torus state, which is Wi is a basis of a degenerate state on the torus. Okay, And the S is a 90-degree rotation. We rotate 90-degree, then make inner product. So this S hat is a 90-degree rotation. So this is S matrix. And this inner product have a geometrical representation as a partition function is this. We have a S3, so three-dimensional sphere with two linked loop R and J. These two linked loop are actually this string operator. We have two string operator embedded in the space-time, and they're linked. And this is S matrix. And from here, immediately we can see that S matrix is always a symmetric. You know, IJ can exchange. Okay, so now I'll explain why we have this. So from here to here, there's some jump, but so I'll explain in, not here. Okay, yeah, I should explain. So why we have here? So you remember, this WI is a solid torus with a I inside, a WJ solid torus with a J inside. Okay. Then you have two solid torus. Want to glue them together. If you glue them together in the usual way, what you have? Then this disk. You glue two disks together, it became a sphere. Then you get S2 cross S1, if you glue them in the usual way. But however, you can glue them by rotating 90 degree. When you glue them after 90 degree rotation, you don't get S2 cross S1, it's something else. This is something else is S3. And then one really new, so there you can glue two solid torus by 90 degree rotation. You really get a sphere, don't get a donut or something. but that's require some drawing. But one way to see that you don't have a non-contractible loop. Because non-contractible loop for this solid torus, when you glue the other solid torus, it became the other one for the other solid torus. So it can be contract from within the other solid torus. So at least this one you can convince yourself. The pi one is trivial. There's no non-trivial pi one after this that kind of gluing. So actually this is the S3. And I don't know how to draw it. Maybe you can Google something, maybe someone would draw for you how this is. So this is really the magic. So the partition function sphere with two linked loop give you this S matrix. Okay. And then we can derive the Valenda formula. So with this preparation, we can derive Valenda formula very easily, but in this form. Okay. So we are using the surgery formula. So the surgery formula we are going to use is that we have a product two partition function. So this is very general. We have there's one space-time manifold, another space-time manifold. So we have this product two partition function. And then we have a cut. We assume that these two boundaries are same. You know, somehow these two boundaries are same. Okay? And then we claim that this product equal to the other product, where we can exchange the upper one. So now it's M became, we change the lower one here. The M became N and N became M. And why is that? But here we have to a condition. We require that on this boundary B, the vector space has to be one-dimensional. Remember, on every spatial manifold, we have vector space. If this vector space is one-dimensional, then this works. And actually, it's quite trivially, because if vector space is one-dimensional, that means those states live on a boundary coming from this path integral are all one-dimensional vector. They all parallel. The only magnitude that are important. So therefore, this kind of inner product are really just a multiplication of numbers, because they're all one-dimensional vector space. They are really just numbers. When you multiply a number together, suddenly you can multiply them in different order. It's just different order multiply the same number. Once they are one-dimensional, they become number. You can exchange them. Okay. And so, uh, uh, but this seemingly innocent relation is pretty powerful. This a lot to prove to get a Vanita formula. So here is the following. We have a S3 with one loop, and another S3 with one loop, and also two linked loop. So this is the thing. Then on this boundary, what we have a sphere, S2. And with a particle antiparticle, because this loop I is a particle antiparticle. So when you have a sphere with a particle antiparticle, their fusion space is still one dimensional. There's not multi-dimensional, still one dimensional. So this condition is one dimensional condition is okay. And then, but the magic comes from here. So we do this cut, then we exchange the bottom. Then we get these two results. This result, then now it's only one link. And this sphere with one link is just a 2S. That's how we get these 2S. Okay. But now this one is tricky. Here we have this what do you say? We have two link. But these two link can be merged, because now you can see we have J link and K link. We can bring them together. That's become a fusion of J and K. So so here we make a big assumption. This is a big assumption. We have a string operator. The string operator fusion, the product algebra of a string operator is really the fusion algebra. Mathematicians don't assume this. So the way mathematicians show this may be more complicated. But as a physicist, we can assume this. And then the whole thing became very simple. So now this JK loop became NIJK times I string, L string operator. And this single loop I can be viewed as I linked with a trivial string. So this became SI1, that's I linked with trivial string. And this one is I linked with L. But L is a fusion of J and K, so there's a fusion coefficient here. And that's it. This is just a Wallander formula. This is a more general way. So this formula works even when S is not invertible. So Wallander formula assume S is invertible and unitary. Then you can move one of them to other side. Actually move this side, move here to this side. You get a Wallander formula. But if even S is not invertible, this one is still correct. Yes?
Sure, maybe I missed your point, but how do you know that this cut has one dimension?
If there's no ring, the cut became a sphere. Then this axiom on the sphere, the degeneracy always one. So actually, all topological order have this property. On the sphere is one. On the torus is not one. On the sphere is one. But here's the more complicated. It's a sphere with a particle antiparticle. But that's also one, because particle antiparticle, when it fuses, there's only one way to fuse. So there's always a one. But this is pretty non-trivial. So we use these properties. And so I'm pretty happy, by this some assumption. It's not really rigorous mathematically, but physically it looks pretty simple and reasonable. So you can get this Wallander formula. So then there is also a relation between there is also a relation between the quantum dimension and S. Yeah. So actually this remember S1i is just one loop. And this if you remember what Michael said, this single loop is a D, is a quantum dimension. Again, there is a pretty magical. So here we also have this result. This single one loop is a I is a this single loop is a related to quantum dimension. Okay. So how to see that? The way to see that is the following. We assume we have vector V. You can ignore the I for the moment. You have a V, which is whose component is SI1, SI2, SI3, etc. So we have a vector. Okay. Then the Wallander formula I wrote here, if you stare for 10 minutes, you'll see that it's actually can be written in this form. So it is using this vector. It's really this identical, just rewrite it. And I make a mistake. This is supposed to be lambda jk. Yeah, this is wrong. This should be lambda ki. Yeah, this is a mistake here. So it is really is that is a vi is a so v is the eigenstate of n with eigenvalue lambda basically, and so this lambda is this, yeah, is that, okay. So that's a Van Lennep formula, and also that and also we see that this this SI1 is a norm of these states. You know, it's a norm of these states. You know, SI1 is just this sphere. It's really norm of this a pair of I bar. It's a norm of that. So SI1 always positive. So this vector is very special. This vector whose component all positive. But since N is a positive matrix, and the one with eigenvector also have all positive coefficient, that means this eigenvalue is the largest eigenvalue. Yeah. So therefore, this is this ratio is a di. It's the largest eigenvalue. And so as a result, so actually Si1, S1i is really the quantum dimension up to a factor. This factor is a total quantum dimension. It's a d squared is sum over di squared. So that's what you'll get. So this S matrix have very, very nice structure. The first column, first row are basically quantum dimension, scaled by some factor. Yeah. So that is this result is also obtained. And including this link. So actually, this two-linked loop. The two-linked loop is this ratio. The way to see that is falling. We know that this path integral is SI1. Okay. But we can interpret this as a partition function S3, which is S11, because if this I became trivial loop, that's became partition function on S3. So therefore, we can divide by S11. So then this partition function S3 also S11. So we can write this way. But then we can see that the single loop, this is the partition function with loop and without loop differ by di. So then we claim that a single loop have a weight di. And for the same reason, we can say that a partition function with a two-linked loop and without two-linked loop differ by this phase. So then we say that the two-linked loop have amplitude here. In the same way as the single loop have amplitude di. Yeah. So using this surgical formula, we have this nice result. The single loop is di, two-linked loop is Sij, S matrix, times this total quantum dimension. Yeah. So this is we get this. So now we are building up our toolbox in the graphic calculus. So with this result, you can do more calculation. And okay, one of the calculations, that's an independent calculation, but not using the tool yet. So this calculation associated with the twist. And remember that we mentioned that the particle, like the F particle, are really bound state of M and E. But M in the plaquette, E live on the vertex. No matter how tight they bind, they belong to different lattices. So they're not really point-like. So they kind of split it. So therefore, in general, it's bad to view the particle as point-like without internal structure. Actually, those particles, in general, may have internal structure. Okay. So just like this EM example. So therefore, it's better to represent this internal structure explicitly by framing. So here is that for the particle I, we can have just a particle I. But we can add a framing to be more precise. Why we want to do that? Because we want to do rotation. If you have particle is point-like, you do 360 rotation, nothing happens. So it's hard to see why there's a phase change. But actually, particle do have internal structure. So we should not use point to describe particle. We should use 2-point. And so here's a framing. And so usually when I draw the two-dimensional graph like this, you can think there's a canonical framing, which is just in the z direction. You just lift this graph in the z direction, then there's a parallel curve. So there's a canonical way to draw framing. So that's why when I draw a graph like that, I do not draw framing because I assume a canonical framing. Okay. But here you can see that. So here's an example. We have a particle goes like this with a canonical framing. So here the framing is below the surface. So we have a loop, we have something below the surface that's framing. And here you probably need a bell to pull them. But if you pull this, then you'll find this canonical framing became twisted if you make this loop become a straight line. So actually it's twisted by itself by 2 pi. So therefore the canonical framing of this kind of loop kind of correspond to the twisting particle by 2 pi. Okay. And so therefore these two are different by this 2 pi twist. So there's a phase of 2 pi si here. Yeah. So compare, basically compare the one with a twist and the without twist, they differ by 2 pi. Okay. So therefore this a but however if you kind of this kind of loop below a loop above, you know, these two both have a phase, 2 pi I s I, and the other one, this b, they both have this phase. So it's very hard to see, but you have to be very careful. There's two orientation, you have a two phase loop. Okay. And this one is related to the Dain twist, this t. That's also very easy to see. Because here, I'm not drawing this very nicely, but you can imagine we have a loop I, string operator I, buried inside. But our Dain twist is really in the solid torus, we just twist this way. So by 2 pi. So therefore, when you do Dain twist, and this loop inside is twisted by 2 pi. So therefore, by comparison, with the loop, without the loop, they differ by this 2 pi twist of this string operator, and then you have by this 2 pi I s I. That's it. So that's it. But however, there's this shift of C over 24. I don't know where it's coming from. And then I kind of now wave my hand and conjecture and dreaming, you know. And so it might come from when you do the twist, you know, the metric is changed. You know, the before twist and after twist, the background metrics changed. And but we know there's a Weissmuller, this is a topological chain Simon term. This is a gravitational chain Simon term. And I wish this metric change will cause a change of a gravitational chain Simon term, which provide this factor. So this will be one of the research paper I can write. So this is probably is really coming from there. So at the moment, I didn't do the calculation, so right now I'm just guessing.
By wish, you mean you wish the chain Simon term takes that exact form?
Exactly. Due to a change of a metric, so therefore you can evaluate chain Simon form before twist and after twist. The difference is this.
But the 24 is your guess.
Hmm?
But the 24 is your guess.
No, I hope this just come from this. This just come from here, yeah.
Oh.
I think there's some other reason why you believe it's 24. There's other calculation. And here there's I present some physicist way to look at fusion category. It's not rigorous, but combined with a lot of physical intuition, the physical picture of this many body system. And then those results are things pretty simple to obtain. That's basically. So now we understand how the T and S are related by this way. Then the last relation is this another relation is this relation that we can get Sijk S matrix from Nijk. And how do you get that? It's not too bad actually. And first we notice that this kind of loop actually is give us a spin. So the spin is a figure eight. And the easy to see is that because we can make this hook, this loop, straighten this loop, give us a spin. So that's from here, that's a definition. This is because we already explained this. And this single loop is a D. So therefore, this figure eight is just have a spin in it. Okay. And then we also explain that this two linked loop is this. Okay, this we already explained. Now we have two parallel particles like I, J fused together have a figure eight. You know, that's so we consider this. And this picture can be viewed as this picture. By sliding, you have this loop, by sliding, you can slide, there's two loop here, you can slide one loop underneath. Again, it's hard to see, but I had to stay there for a few minutes. You can slide into this way. When into this way, you can see that now here you have a loop which is Si, here a loop is Sj, you know. Now became two loop with linked, and that is S matrix. And that's it. So this is this way. However, this quantity have another way to compute. We can compute another way. Using the fusion of a string operator. Again, using the fusion of string operator, which is usually people don't do, because that's the additional setup, additional assumption, nobody knows where it comes from. But as a physicist, we believe that. So using fusion of string operator, so now this ij became nijk with a k string. But the k figure eight is just like this. You know, it's just a dk with sk is this. Then this is really just this. Yeah. So this formula is pretty easy to obtain. So this is really the graphic calculus. So this here we really use the graphic calculus. One can play a game like that. You can get all kinds of relations. And here's another relation. It's called a Waffle formula and by Ettinghoff. And who told me that Greg get very angry. So we should have more alpha theorem. Okay, and so actually these two papers probably is in the same year. I don't know. I think this paper maybe earlier. And so we have another relation. And this relation is a mess. Okay, it's this relation. So what is this relation? This relation will tell us the S, this spin is a rational number. So actually that's both papers try to claim the conformal weight must be a rational number. So there's a rational conformal field theory. That's where it comes from. So how I show this S is a rational number? Because the S have the relation. This V is the integer matrix of maybe integer tensor. So basically you can view this R is one index. This IJKL is another index. So it's a big rectangular matrix. So this integer matrix multiplied this SR gave you 0 mod 1. So that determines the S to be rational number. But this V integer matrix is very complex, have this kind of combination. You can derive from this Nijk, you know, you can get this V. But where this come from? Well, this comes from this figure, this kind of graphic calculus. And so this more Waffle theorem come from this graphic calculus. So we have a four particle on a sphere. IJKL, okay, and then we move I around the J once. So that's like a mutual statistics. We have a mutual statistics. We should get something like the ratio for these spins. Remember, this mutual statistic can be obtained as a ratio for spins. So this is what we get. We're supposed to get something like that. But the trouble is how many terms? There's many terms. Okay. But how many terms? It's really fusion. First, I have to figure out what's the dimension of the fusion space in IJKL. What's the dimension? You know, this matrix, this you know, when you do this Bayer's space, this Bayer's space is a big matrix. But what's the dimension of this matrix? Well, then we just do the fusion. So here's the fusion. We can fuse IJ to R, and R with K to L bar. So this combination tell me the dimension of the fusion, we fuse ij into r. And then we fuse this r with k into l bar, which annihilate with l. So that's how we do the fusion. And this particular fusion is very convenient to compute this kind of braiding, because in this fusion, ij fuses into r. So we know the fusion channel. So in this channel, ij fuses into r gave us a phase. That's phase. Sisj and fuses into r gave this ratio gave us that phase. And how many of such phase? Well, it's really this. Nijr is how many of those phase. OK, so that's nijr. But however, this r can also fuse with a k to get many factors. So this factor should be also included. So therefore, total factor of this ija fuses into r, r fuses with something else, the total factor is this. And when you sum over all possible r channel, you get this. But however, for different r channel, this phase factor different. So we have a multiplication with different r channel. So we get this phase. And so this careful calculation of this of moving I through J, this loop. So if you know the fusion space, thinking carefully, this is pretty straightforward. Then we can do moving I around the K. In this case, it's better to fuse IK first. You know, if you still fuse IJ first, it'll be mess. It's better to do this calculation in a fuse IK first. If you fuse IK first, then it becomes this. You fuse IK first. IK fuses into R, R fuses with J to L bar. So we get something like, we fuse IK first into R, you get something like that. Okay, then this the determinant of this unitary matrix, it can multiply all these eigenvalues, so we get this. And for the last one, we do I around this JK, the combination of JK. And in this case, we should fuse this JK first into R, then fuse R with then fuse R and I into L bar. But R I fuse no L bar determine this statistic. So there's a L bar here up here. But anyway, so you get a mess. So this is really a mess. So now I have this factor, but then these three factors have this condition. You know, they you know, doing this twice equal to doing it once. And then you just collect all these messy factors together and using some identity of this N matrix. N matrix have some identities. Then combine all that, you derive this formula. So this formula is nothing but just this formula. But the exponentialized, a log of this formula, just get this. Yeah. So that you get this. And that's about it, actually. So those are conditions. This is the condition between N and S. You know, S and N are related. And so we get all these conditions. And so then we can collect all these conditions together. You know, that's so we have N. N satisfies this condition. In terms of matrix, this N matrix commute. This is very easy to write down, this N matrix commute. And then this, then we have this Moore-Waffa relation. N and S are related, okay. And then we have this condition from modular matrix. We from N S to get ST, you know, to get ST. And ST have this condition as a reputation for a modular group. The last one didn't derive. Yeah, there's a some short forbidding short indicator. Yeah, this one. There is a category to derive it, I wonder whether there is a simple way. If there is a simple way, I would get it, and maybe I present some other time. But I don't have a simple way, so I don't present this. So there's a last formula, it's a forbidden Schultz indicator, is related to, yeah. And this collection seems enough. We don't know, yeah. We may miss in condition, you know, but seems enough. So we just get as much as possible. And the next is just a coding, you know, you just put this condition on a computer and search them. Find NIJKS to solve this condition. How to do it is pretty easy. You know, N is an integer matrix. just search through all integer matrix, certain with certain bound, you know. So element should be smaller than certain things with certain smart bound. Just exhaust all those ones and check which one satisfy those conditions and those other conditions. And like a filter, you collect those, satisfy those conditions. And then you're solving this to, for the S. You know, you can solve this, Smith normal form. One can solve this condition. You can diagonalize this rectangular matrix. You can solve this condition very easily. You can using Smith's normal form to put this rectangular matrix in a diagonal form. Then this one can be solved very easily. Then you can find a collection of S, which is satisfy this condition. They all finite site, finite set. So, and when you get this N and S, then you just check those conditions and select those satisfy everything. And that's it. And then that's how you create a table of a modular fusion category. So that's a table for bosonic topology order. So this is a table. Actually, there's a much longer. So this is only rank 5. So that means there's a, including a trivial particle, there's a 5 particles. Yeah. And so here we can probably can do, I don't know, 8 or 9 something. But certainly up to a certain total quantum dimension. OK. And there are a lot of familiar things. So there's a like these Laughlin states. Here I want to explain that I label every state by their spin and the quantum dimension. I should use nijk. That's more information. You know, nijk have more information. But nijk as a rank 3 tensor, I don't know how to write that in one line. You know, it's very long. So sometimes it happens. Sometimes there are different nijk have the same quantum dimension. Then on this table looks like the same, but they are really different entry. But this case you can check individually to see are the same or not. But usually this label is pretty okay. You usually not degenerate. So this quantum dimension and the spin. And so here, like in this quantum Hall states, like we have two particles. This first one is always a trivial particle. So quantum dimension 1, spin 0. The second particle is a non-trivial, which have a quantum dimension 1, means abelian. Spin quarter means it's semian. So that's exactly this Laughlin states. So the Fibonacci states is this quantum dimension is non-zero now. This is combination. Looks like all the quantum dimension can be written in this particular function. And this is the quantum dimension of a power fermion. So there's something really suggestive. So the power fermion is everything, looks like. And the spin will be the, you know, 2/5 here. This is double layer, 2-to-1 double layer states for this. And this is some kind of Kasmoudian algebra states, okay. And this absolute level 2 is this one. And this Pfaffian state is this one. Actually, they are different. They have same quantum dimension, but the spin are different. Okay. And et cetera. And there's one thing I want to say that you can see that here we have 8 state. We have 8 state here. They all have 3 particles. And same quantum dimension, only difference is the spin are different. Okay. But why have 8 of this? Well, these 8 states are related because here we have a spin 1. This is a quantum dimension 1, the bosonic, Abelian statistics. 1/2 means the fermion. So we have a fermion here. And this we can condensing the fermion into the filling frog integer quantum Hall states, which do not change quantum dimension, but may dress the statistics. So all these 8 states are differed by integer quantum Hall states of this 1/2 particle. You can also condensing this 1/2 particle into p-IP states. Then you get this one. So actually, these two states are differed by this p+IP. We think, you know. So that's we get 16 of them. So that's this 16-fold way. That's this to condensing a fermionic particle into PPAS IP or integer quantum Hall states, then you generate these 16 states. That's the blue one. The double summons here and et cetera. Yeah. Okay, and so that's it. So we can using this to generate this table for topological order. And it turns out that so there's a concern. There's a maybe fake entry because we worry about our condition is not enough. So we may have a solution which do not satisfy some other condition which we didn't realize yet. So that means that this table may have a fake entry. So some entry is not realizable. It turns out that at least so far so good. So we can using this Kasmuni algebra or conformal field theory method to construct every one of entry in the table. So all of the entry in the table can be constructed using the conformal field theory. So far so good. But here, let me just very quickly say that why this entry is enough. Because there's a very important requirement that this S is unitary. I think somewhere. Okay, yeah, this C is invertible. So S squared equal to C means S is invertible. So this condition really say that S is invertible. So S is invertible really means the following, that every particle can be remotely detected. This is a very important concept. That is, when you have a particle, then you can always detect the presence of this particle somewhere in the middle by braiding some other particle very far away, like a light year away from this particle. So there's always a remote detector for every topological particle. So there's a reason for this particle to be non-trivial because there exists remote detector. And this is very important. If there is some topological particle, there's no remote detector, then physically would believe this particle actually is not topological, it's just spin flip. We should view this particle as identity. Okay, so except identity, every other particle should be remotely detectable. So this is a condition associated with that this theta ijk is non-trivial, or this S matrix is invertible. Okay, this is very, very important. So the only thing which have a trivial mutual statistic with everybody else is identity, is a trivial particle. And this concept have a mathematical thing, is that suppose in some other Brady diffusion category, we have some non-trivial particle, which have a non-trivial braiding with everybody else, then this subset is called a centralizer. So this have this notation. It's a centralizer of this category. It's a set of particles which have trivial braiding with everybody else. Why I say that? Because remember for the example we described using categorical way to describe a symmetry, there all the representation have a trivial mutual statistic with everybody else. So actually those are trivial representation from the symmetry are really centralizer. Okay. So with this understanding, then we can immediately obtain a theory with a symmetry. Is that for the bosonic topological order with symmetry? It means it's a Brady diffusion category, but with a subset which corresponds to this representation of a group, and this subset have a trivial braiding with everybody else, and every other particle have a non-trivial braiding, and that's it. So therefore, to classify the Brady diffusion category with a symmetry, a topological order with symmetry, we should consider Brady diffusion category with this with a subset whose centralizer is not zero, but given by this symmetric fusion category, which is a repetition theory. Okay, yeah, that's another thing. And for the fermion without symmetry, we will have Z2 fermion parity symmetry, so it also have a centralizer. Basically, the parent fermion would have a trivial braiding with everybody else. And for fermion topological with symmetry, you have a super representation, something like that. But however, this is not quite enough, because if you only have this condition, the symmetry may be anomalous. So you have an additional condition that those symmetry are gaugeable. The gaugeable means that you can add particles which is like a vortex from the central twist. You can add the particle to make whole thing modular again. You can, this is not modular because I have a particle which have a trivial burden with everybody else. The modular one means you have no such particle. Every particle have a non-trivial burden with everybody else. But this one is not modular because I have a symmetry part. But when you add a symmetry twist, the symmetry twist would have a non-trivial burden with this representation. And to make everything have a remotely detectable, so that's like a modular extension. So existence of modular extension means gaugeable, because this symmetry twist is coming from gauging the symmetry. So therefore, to be more precise, I think, do I say this? I didn't say it here, is that it's a Brady diffusion category with this property plus additional requirement. It contains modular extension. And this is the wonderful theory to classify boson topology, fermion topology with symmetry and etc. in 2+1D. And so here is a table. So here is a table for the boson for fermionic topology order. And so there's so this is a fermionic topology order with a Z4 F symmetry. Let me see, what do I have a bosonic? So this is a fermionic topology, and this is a, yeah, this is like a bosonic topology with a Z2 symmetry. You know, this, these first two particles have a trivial mutual statistics with everybody else, so that's like a centralizer. But there's the other particles. So basically just using this method, we can get, yeah, I think I finished. Yeah. So this is about the everything we have. Yeah. Thank you. Maybe you should go into this session immediately. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We don't know. Yeah, this is one open question. I don't know, and I doubt actually. If I don't have modular expansion, there's many solutions sometimes, and looks like using modular expansion, we know we have a valid theory. Without modular extension, the one with the centralizer is a little out of control. So the condition we list may not be enough for the non-modular. I hope there's a more condition. Very good question. Oh, on set, yes. We don't know how to do time well.